cryptography and information security. So let's start. So as you know, this is the different terminologies we used here when we discuss this subject. I'm going one by one. The sender is intended to send some message to the recipient. Okay. Now the sender, what is typing or whatever is his message, is known as plain text. So plain text is an unencrypted text what we can read and understand. Okay. But problem is that if you simply transmit the plain text over the internet or network, anybody can tap it, anybody can copy it and reveal the secret, and even they can use it for some illegal purpose, right? So what the sender can do? The sender can encrypt the text, encrypt the plain text, and generate a cipher text. So what is this encryption process? We already have some idea. It is needed one encryption algorithm and one key, right? So with help of this key, the encryption algorithm will change the plain text into a cipher text. So cipher text is a transformed version of your plain text, and it cannot be read or understand by third party who does not have the key which is needed to decrypt it. So I think it is clear what is ciphertext. Now, as this is not going to be understood by anybody who does not have the key, it is quite secure to transmit over the internet or public channel. So that is what happens. The sender then sends this ciphertext over channel or through internet to the recipient. But before recipient read it, or try to read it or understand it, again recipient need to decrypt the message. That decrypt the message means recipient must have the secret key which is needed to transform the ciphertext back to its plain text. Okay, then only the plain text can be read. So definitely, if it is a legitimate recipient, a legal one, or which is intended by the sender, then definitely somehow the key need to be there with the recipient. Okay, how this key is going to be transmitted from sender to recipient, that is another question. We will see that later. Okay, so we are assuming here that somehow this key is being shared, okay, or transmitted. Now the recipient use that key and use a decryption algorithm to decrypt the ciphertext to plain text and read it. So all these terms, I think, clear to you. What is plain text, what is encryption, what is decryption, what is ciphertext, and what are the key. Okay. Now, before we go forward, we need to understand the Kirchhoff's law. What does this law or principle says? It has a basic assumption that the system is completely known to the attacker, and only the key is secret. That means system known means the encryption and decryption algorithm is known to everybody, the attacker, sender, receiver, and everybody. Okay, and only secret is the key. That means key is with the sender or who is encrypting, and it should be with the recipient who is supposed to decrypt it. Okay. So this is also known as Kirchhoff's law, that is, crypto algorithms are not secret. So algorithms are definitely not secret, as I have already told you. Why do we make this assumption? Experience has shown that the secret algorithms are weak when exposed. Okay. And secret algorithms never remain secret, because the same algorithm is going to be used by a huge number of people, same algorithm, so everybody knows the algorithm. So you can't claim that my algorithm is a secret. Okay, So most of the cases, algorithm is does not remain secret until it is a proprietary item for particular purpose. Somebody, or some enterprise developed it and used for by themselves. Like Google have some algorithms which are not basically related to too much of security. I mean, like data analytics and other analytics algorithm, they does not make it public. But most of the cases, security algorithms or encryption, decryption algorithms are public. Okay. Now, better to find weakness beforehand. So if you make the algorithm open to everybody, then in a faster way, we will find what are the weakness of the algorithm. So that is another good thing. Now, if you say that ancient ciphers, it start the well documented documented history almost around 3100 before Christ or BC. So that time ancient Egyptians enciphered some of their hieroglyph written on monuments. So that is the first evidence of cipher. Then around 100 before Christ, 100 BC, there's a Julius Caesar used a simple substitution cipher known as Caesar cipher. We will see what is Caesar cipher later. Okay. Then around 1200 after Christ, definitely around 1200, Roger Bacon described several methods of ciphers or crypto systems. Around 1392, that Geoffrey Cosover introduced several ciphers in his work, and in 1460s, Leon Alberti derived a cipher wheel and described the principle of frequency analysis. So you will find a little after that frequency analysis is a very important method of cryptanalysis. That means attacking the ciphers. Okay. Then later in 1553, Wigner cipher Wigner is a cipher. Okay. It is invented by Giovanni Battista Bellaso. Okay, then in 1585, the Blaise de Wigner, this Wigner is a person also. Okay, so this cipher was named by this person's name, and who was a cryptologist. Okay, so Wigner published a book on cryptology and described poly alphabetic substitution cipher. So here what you can see, few things. Substitution cipher, cipher wheel, Caesar cipher, right? So many of them we are going to cover, frequency analysis. Okay. So classical cryptographic techniques have two basic components of classical cipher. One is substitution and another is transposition. And still now, this substitution and transpositions are in use. The method is changed, they become complex. But same substitution, same transposition, still we use in encryption algorithms. Then substitution ciphers are ciphers where letters are replaced by other letters. This is the reason it is called substitution. You substitute one letter by some other letter. And transposition ciphers are the cipher. The letters are arranged in different order. These ciphers may be monoalphabetic cipher or polyalphabetic cipher. Okay, so what happens in transposition cipher? The letters in the text are simply jumbled or scrambled. Okay, so it can be monoalphabetic, it can be polyalphabetic. We'll see what are those things. Then several such cipher may be concatenated together to form a product cipher. So nowadays you will find that many of the ciphers are combinations of substitution and transposition. Okay, so that we will find later. Now, classical cryptography, first thing comes is monoalphabetic ciphers. Once a key is chosen, each alphabet character of the plain text is mapped onto a unique alphabetic character of a ciphertext. So the Swift cipher, a Caesar cipher is one of the examples. The substitution ciphers are this kind of cipher, and the affine cipher is also a monoalphabetic cipher. So here, if you see, this is one of the simple example of substitution cipher named as ATBAS. So what is this? If you see, we have a wheel where A to Z are written in the outer circle. You can see it, right? And in the inner circle, you can see that the alphabets are written, but it is in reverse order. So what is A is mapped to Z, B is mapped to Y, C is mapped to X, D is mapped to W, and Z is mapped to A, and so on, right? So this is what is called ATBAS cipher, where the alphabets are just reversed. Okay, so what happens if you see this is a cipher, is a plain text. In cipher text, you will find T becoming, where is T in outer one? T becoming, T is mapped with G. So see, G is came here. Then TH, H is mapped with S. So see, S came here, and so on, right? So this is nothing but alphabets are mapped by writing the alphabets in reverse order and simply replace the alphabets in the plain text by the corresponding mapped alphabet in the cipher text. Clear? So can you tell me what is the strength of this cipher? Or if I encrypt a text like this and send to you, and if I don't give what cipher I have used, how much time will it take to break it? So thing is that frequency analysis is one of the way to break this cipher. Okay, and frequency analysis. What is frequency analysis? That I will go into detail a little bit later. Next is coming the Caesar cipher. So Caesar cipher is called as a shift cipher. So it is also a monoalphabetic cipher and reputedly used by Julius Caesar. So by his name, it is called as Caesar cipher, and replace each letter of message by a letter in a fixed distance away. So it is it can be calculated like x plus n mod 26. So if I just this inner circle is moving, right? It is basically moving, but if you stop it anywhere, then it can be like this. If you stop at A here in the outer circle, and that inner circle, say if you stop under C, D, then what will happen? A will be mapped to D, right? A will be mapped to D, B will be mapped to E, C will be mapped to F. That means what is happening here, that every alphabet is shifted by 3, and whatever you are encountering after the on the third spot from that alphabet, you are taking that one as the replacement of the current alphabet in plain text. So like if you see, your plain text is attack at once and shift is 4. So this is your key here, okay? Because who will decrypt, he have to know how many letters you have shifted. So what is going to happen? A and shift 4. See, A, 1, 2, 3, 4. After 4 shift, we got E. So A is going to be replaced by E. The same way T, shift 4, where is T? T is here. 1, 2, 3, 4. What you are getting? X. So X is coming here. Then again another T, so another X is coming here, and so on. So in this way, you can understand that every character in plain text, that means all 26 characters, will have a unique map in the ciphertext with some other character, right? So frequency of the characters, are not going to change in the ciphertext and plaintext. How I will show you later. Okay. So for doing this, modular arithmetic is used to do it in a mathematically faster way. So so there is four properties of modular arithmetic. First one is, if a mod n equal to b mod n, then there is an integer k such that a minus b equal to k multiply n. Okay. Another rule is, a plus b mod n equal to a mod n plus b mod n. The result of this is of mod n are same. Then a multiplication b mod n equal to a mod n multiplication b mod n, and the result of this mod n are same. Minus a mod n equal to n minus a mod n. So with example, if you see the first one, if a mod n equal to b mod n, then there is an integer k such that a minus b equal to k multiplication n. Now if you have a equal to 17, n is equal to 5, then a mod n, that is 17 mod 5 equal to 2, right? We all know. So a minus b, so what is b here? This is b, 2. Okay, 17 minus 2 equal to k into 5, n, k into n. So we say k we don't know for the time being. Okay, n is 5, we already know. So which is, so 17 minus 2 equal to 15, k into 5, so k is 3. Okay, so this is the first rule. Second rule is the distribution of addition. If you have a equal to 17, b equal to 3, and n equal to 5, then if you see this one, 17 mod 5 and 3 mod 5 mod 5. If you do this, then from this 17 mod 5 will give you 2, 3 mod 5 will give you 3. So 2 plus 3 mod 5 equal to 0. You all know, right? 5 mod 5 is 0. Now if you directly do it here, 17 plus 3, a plus b means 17 plus 3, 20, 20 mod n is 5. So 20 mod 5 is 0, we all know, right? So this is satisfying. Go to the next one, the multiplication or distribution of the multiplication operation again is 17, b is 3, and n is equal to 5. If you do a mod n multiplication with b mod n mod 5, so a mod n is 2, we know, and 3 mod 5 or b mod 5 is 3, we already know. You multiply them together, you will get 3 into 2, or 2 into 3 equals 6, so 6 mod 5 equal to 1. Okay, if you calculate this, 17 into 3 mod 5, you will get 1. Okay, the third one is minus a mod n equal to n minus a mod n. So say again, a is equal to 17, n equal to 5, then calculating this side, right, left hand side is a bit difficult. If you can take this one, you can see n is 5, so 5 minus a mod 5, okay, and 17 mod 5 equal to 5 minus, I know this result is 2, so 5 minus 2, so 5 minus 2 equal to 3, so the result is 3. Okay, so if you are going to use work with CSS cipher, you have to understand these rules. Okay, now cryptanalysis of CSS cipher, only 26 possible ciphers. Why 26 possible ciphers? Because every time you are arranging or you are mapping the characters in plain text to cipher text, you will have only 26 option. That means a is the alphabet in the plain text, it can be mapped to a, b, c, or d, or e, up to z. So you have only 26 possibilities to map a with. okay, could simply try each term by exhaustive key search. Okay, so how I was telling you about frequency analysis. So what happens, you can see in the plain text what is the frequency of a certain letter, and in ciphertext you find which letter is having same frequency, then you will know that okay, this letter is mapped to that letter. Okay, so now you can do frequency analysis based on single letter, you can do frequency analysis by double letter, or you can do frequency analysis based on triple letters or three letters. Okay, now question is that you can say that if the attacker does not have the plain text and ciphertext together at a time, then how he will do frequency analysis? Now the good thing here is that for the attacker, he does not need to know the plain text, because the English language is having a certain frequency analysis of alphabets, and which is true almost, you know, almost for any long amount of text. So if you say this, if you take the dictionary words and if you calculate frequency of each character, you will find that character E or alphabet E is having maximum frequency in the text. It is around, I think, 11 point something. Yeah, okay, around 11 it is. Okay, so like T comes next, O comes next, and so on. Okay, so and this frequency, you know, roughly is maintained for almost all the documents. Okay, now what will happen if you get a cipher and where you are finding that, say, the letter Q is having frequency 11, then you can simply assume that E is mapped to Q in the cipher. So first, what you will do, you will replace Q by E. Then again, you will find that which character is having quite similar frequency with T, quite similar frequency with O, and we just keep replacing them. Okay, and in this way, finally, we will find most of the characters you have been, or 100% characters you have replaced, and you can roughly read the text, you know, after replacing the character in the ciphertext. So without knowing the key, without knowing your original plain text, taking a simple ciphertext, you can do frequency analysis and you can find out what was the plain text. So that is another reason this is considered as a weak cipher, and it is not been used in modern time, because, you know, using computer, this is very easy to implement. Then comes affine cipher. So what does happens in affine cipher? So it assigns number to each of the character. Okay, like A is considered a 0th character, B 1, and Z is 25th. Okay, and this is also based on modular arithmetic. Okay, but here is some addition. Previously we was using modular arithmetic to just finding out after shifting what character will come. Here, not only that, we are taking A and B two different number which are considered as key of this cipher. And how we are calculating the cipher? A multiplication with X. Now what is X? X is the index. Okay, these values are X value. Okay, so if you have a character C, then X will be considered as 2. Okay, so how we'll calculate the cipher? We will do A, say here it is given 5, so A into X, if X is C, then it is going to be 2, plus B, B is here given 8. Okay, so whatever we'll get, mod M we will do. Okay, so what will happen in this case, you are still having 26, option to map with, because, after doing this calculation, whatever number we'll get, and as you are doing, mod M, that number is going to be, less than 26. So again, it is going to map with one of the character each time. Now problem is that numbers of time it will happen that for different value of A and B, that multiple character of plain text can be mapped with one character of the plain text can be mapped with multiple character in the ciphertext. Okay, in that case, you know, recovery will be harder. Okay, so if you see here, for example, this is our method of encipherment or encryption. Our key A equal to 5 and B equal to 8 is given. So, and you have a plain text affine cipher. Now, as I had told you, the X values are the location number of these characters. A was 0. If you see the previous slide, A is 0. Location is 0. F is at the fifth location, and so on, and like that. Okay. Now, what do we need to calculate? 5x plus 8. So 5 is A and 8 is B. Okay. So as A is, x is 0 here, 5x is 0 plus 8, so 8 came here, and here x is 5, so 5 into 5, 25 plus 8, we are getting 33 here, and this F also got 33, the I became 48, and so on. This calculation have been done. Then these values are, see, more than, they are greater than 26. Right, and if you think about the indexing from 0 to 25, they are greater than 25, so you can't use them to map with different alphabet. So what do? We mod these numbers by 26, so that every time we know how big it these numbers are, it doesn't matter, it will always be in a range of 26. So that is happened here. Okay, so we got 8 made 26, 8, 33 more 26, 7, 48 more 26, 22, 73 more 26, 21, and so on. Okay, then we go to this table and found that what is the letter is there, or what alphabet is there at this index. Okay, so 8 index, if you see, I. So 8, I. Now 7th index, if you see, you will find H. 22 index, if you see, you will find W. 21 index, if you see, you will find V, and so on. So here only thing is that your key is becoming complex, and you know it is little bit complex mapping, because it is the mapping is not a sequential mapping, it is a random mapping, right? You don't know that which character is going to map to which other character by looking at the key itself, because you have some calculation in between. Okay, so that is what the additional good thing with this affine cipher. But still, it is vulnerable to the frequency analysis, because ultimately, whatever you do, you have 26 options for each of the character. Okay. And how you will decrypt, because you have done this calculation, no? Now, if you want to decrypt, that means how will, if the ciphertext is sent to the recipient, how the recipient will understand that this I means A, H means F, W means I, it is, bit harder, you think, right? So how that recipient will do the decryption process? So if you see, decryption is done by C in bracket X minus B mod M. Now what is C? C is the modular multiplicative inverse of A. That means what? That means A into C equal to 1 mod M. Okay, so M is missing here actually. Okay, so if you take A equal to 5, B equal to 8, okay, you have to find out C. That means, A is 5, you put here, C give you here, 1 mod 26. So now, what value of C, you will get 1 here, in modular 26 calculation, or arithmetic, okay? Now, since if you see 21 into 5, that means if we assume that say is 21, 21 into 5 is giving us 105, 105, okay? And 105 mod 26 is 1, right? So 4 into 26 is equal to 104. So we get 1, okay? So we can say that value of C will be 21. Now, as 26 into 5, so I have already told you. Now, come to the decryption part. In decryption, what we will have to do? We have to do simply C multiplication with X minus B mod M. So we know the value of C for our given key right now. So C is 21. So C, what we are doing? The recipient received this alphabets, sequence of alphabets. So what he does, he find out what are the sequence number of these alphabets. So Y representing the sequence numbers, okay? Now 21, so here this X is actually Y, okay? Now 21, Y minus 8, okay? So Y here it is already 8, and minus 8, so it is giving 0, 7, Y is 7, so 7 minus 8 is minus 1, minus 1 into 21, minus 21, and so on. These values have been calculated using this formula. So again, you can see these values are greater than definitely 26. So we do mod 26. After doing mod 26, they are being, calculated like this, which are mod 26 value. Okay, now again, these are the index which are used to find out the plain text. So at the 0th index, we have A, at the 5 index, we have F, we know, right? So accordingly, this index, from this index, the letters have been picked up and footed together, and we are getting the plain text. Okay, so this is the decryption process of affine cipher. So what are the drawbacks? So key creates the situation where more than one plain text letter is encrypted to same cipher text letter. So that is one of the big problem that one plain text letter can be mapped to some more than one number of letter. So like in above one, if you have been seen properly, both E and R in the plain text are in cipher to B. Okay, if you see here, E and R. Not in this example, but it can happen. Okay, I'm not. Okay, so there is more than one number that can be multiplied by 4 to get 1 modulo 26, right? So regarding this, multiplicative inverse. So, not only 21 is not unique to get, 1. So per different number, you can have, per multiple number, you can have 1 modulo, 1 modulo 26. And solution is that the inverse of modulo M exists if and only if A and M are co-prime. Okay, that means GCD of A comma M equal to 1. Okay, so we have to find out the whether A and M are co-prime, right? So there are 12 numbers less than 26 which are co-prime to 26. Okay, because M is in our case 26, so we have to find out numbers which are less than 26 and co-prime to 26 also. Alphabetic substitutions in general use more than one substitution alphabet and makes cryptanalysis harder, since have more alphabets to guess. And because flattens the frequency distribution, so it is having some harder, bit better than the monoalphabetic situation. And since some plain text letter gets replaced by several cipher text letter depending on which alphabet is used. So let's see. So basically, multiple scissor cipher is called a Wiesner cipher. Wiesner cipher is basically a multiple Fischer cipher. So how it works, it have a key which is combination of multiple letters, and it can be in length, like if one example is given, capital K equal to for K1, K2 up to K3. Okay, so like that it can be. Then ith letter specifies the ith alphabet to use, and use each alphabet in turn, repeating from start after D letters in the masses. So if you see the example, so it was proposed by, I have already told at the beginning, that Battista Bellasso in 1553, and say the key is here jasmine. So these letters J A S M I N E are converted to their location number, and we got this sequence of number 9, 0, 8, 12, 8, 13, and 4. And plain text say we are getting hungry. Okay. Now how we will encrypt using Wiesner cipher? So you can see here, we are getting angry. The letters are here. Then they have been converted to their corresponding location numbers, and then this key is added to them. So repeatedly it is written, say this sequence of number, your key, okay, 9, 0, 18, 12, 8, 13, 4. Then again repeat 9, 0, 18, 12, 13, 4, again repeat. And at the end, if you see, up to 18 only has been used, and then as there was no letters, in the plain text, so the remaining part of the key for the last time is being truncated. Okay. Now after addition, we get these numbers. Okay. And definitely, if you sometimes have a situation like here, 24. Plus 18. So what we had actually, I have written here 16, right? But what we had actually here, after addition, we had 34 plus 8, 42. So now we have, what I have done, 42 mod 26, which is 16. All right. Then this, addition and modulo 26, after doing this, we got this sequence of numbers, and these numbers are again replaced by alphabets which resides on these locations, and this becomes the cipher text. So this is what is Wiesner cipher. So the Wiesner cipher can be presented in a simple table, A to Z in the rows, A to Z in the column, and how many possible map can be there. Okay. So this is how the 16th century people was using this cipher or this encryption system. Okay, and this is a 26x26 table listing all the shapes. Okay, and plain text letter gives the row. So this row are plain text letter, and these are cipher text letter. Okay, applying numerical conversion and the modular addition. Then comes a examination called Kasky examination. What is this? For around 300 late years, it was believed that Wiesner cipher is unbreakable, and it till 1920, people was thinking that this cipher is not breakable. Okay. Then Charles Babbage, I think you have heard the name, and Fenris Kasky independently determined a method of breaking it in the middle of 19th century. Okay, repeated pattern in the text to determine the length of the key. So how they determine the length of the key? By looking at the repeated pattern in the text. Okay, so if you see the in Wiesner cipher, how many keys are possible? Because if you consider brute force, then what is the key space, or suppose the keyword length is M. M means the maximum length possible, that is 26, then there will be total 26 to the power m possible keys. Okay. So m can be anything from 1 to 26. Okay. Now suppose you have m equal to 5, that means the length of the key is 5, then you are going to have 26 to the power 5, which is equal to 1.1 multiplication with 10 to the power 7. This is the key space, that means keys are possible, which is larger enough to percolate excessive key search by hand. So manually you can't break this key using a brute force or excessive key search. We will see that one character could be mapped into m different character when the character is in m different position. So that is again another big problem with this, because if one character is mapping to multiple character, it can pop up some problem at the time of decryption. Okay, then mixed alphabet cipher, the another kind of cipher. The most generally we could use arbitrary mixed or jumbled alphabet. So kind of it is again the kind of your Bignon cipher, and each plain text letter is given a different random cipher text letter, hence key is 26 letter long. So at the beginning what I had told you on cipher, Adbus cipher, what was happening here, there, that you had a plain text A to Z, and we had encoded them by writing Z to A in a reverse order. No, right, the alphabet in reverse order. Then we had mapped A to Z, B to Y, C to X, and so on. So it is, you can say, the advanced part of that. It is saying that why we write in reverse order, or why should I shift? We should jumble the character as we want, or scramble the 26 character as we want. Then we'll map, to each other, like A to D here, B to K, C to B, and so on. Okay, so in this way we will have factorial 26 number of keys. So it is a quite big number of key, and brute force will not be possible. Even today, a normal computer will take half a day, I mean 12 hours minimum to break this key, 26 letter key. Okay, so brute force attack is not possible. The problem is not a number of keys, rather there is lots of statistical information in the masses can solve the problem piece by piece. So brute force is not possible, so don't worry, the attacker will use some other method, like some other statistical method, like frequency attack, then finding out patterns. Because after 26, as your key's length is 26, it will definitely leave some pattern in the cipher text. Okay, then cryptanalysis. Use frequency counts to guess the letter by letter, and also that is what frequency analysis. Also have frequencies for digraph and trigraph. That means you can also apply frequency analysis using digraph and trigraph. You have to find out trigraph and trigraph frequency or histogram from your English dictionary, and then you apply that on the cipher, and you can find out how the characters are being mapped. It is only breaking down the mapping problem, your cipher will be broken. Okay, then general monoalphabetic special case of mixed alphabets. So this is another kind of you can say substitution cipher. Special form of mixed alphabet use key as follows. First write the key with repeated letters deleted, then write all remaining letters in columns underneath, then read of the column to get ciphertext equivalent. Like if you see here, if you have a keyword called monoalphabetic, and as you have told that repeated letters will be deleted, so in mono the second O will be deleted, the remainings are A is here, another A is here, the second A will be deleted, and remaining letters will be kept as a key. Okay, so how it is going to map? If you see, The plain text is, you know, this, and ciphertext is going to be MON, the second O is deleted, ALPH, so on. Okay, and then if you see the last is TIC, right? It's TIC. Okay, so after that, what, right? After that, as we have ended with C, we will continue D, then E we have already written, so E will not write, we will write F, G, H is already written once, so H is not considered, G, H, I is already written, I, then J, K, L is already written here, M is written here, N is written here, O is written here, M, N, O, P is written here, so Q, Q here, Q, R, S, then, you know, T is already written, so T is not considered here. Now we will see the game here. U is mapped to U, V is mapped to V, W is mapped to W, and Z is mapped to Z. So why is it happen? Because in our key, all the letters which are, you know, used in the key, monoalphabetic, they are, you know, coming almost from the beginning. So this effect of not using some letter as they are already being used are not being carried forward up to the end of the mapping. Okay, so you can see here, you know, that is what I have already noted, that U is mapped to U, V is mapped to V, and like that. Okay, so this is a problem with mixed alphabets. Please silence your mics. Okay, so here also the total number of key you can have is factorial of 26. Okay,